Okay. So content ID is a module which is part of security profiles. Not only content ID, security profiles, we have antivirus, we have URL filtering. URL filtering and content filtering will come under this content ID. But we are going to discuss multiple things like spyware, antivirus, vulnerability protection, and all the stuff. Okay? So let's go ahead and look into this content ID. So advantages of content ID is stream based, not file based.
How do you define content ID? Like, what does exactly content ID mean?
Content ID is used to based on the data which is passing through your data plane of your Palo Alto device. Based on the content, like your protocol or your payload part of your IP or TCP packet, based on the content which it is transferring, we are going to protect against threats. That is nothing but your content ID. See, content ID is nothing but your any packet which is hitting to your data plane of your Palo Alto device. What it is going to do is, it is going to inspect the content, the payload part of your packet, against a series of things. A series of things like antivirus, vulnerability protection, botnet, malware, and all the stuff. That is nothing but your content filtering. Content ID, which we will say. Other vendors will call as content filtering. Okay? So, advantages of content ID include, see here, this is because of single pass architecture. What happens? All the signatures will be parallelly verified across your table. Now, whenever your packet hits, okay, if you have enabled encoding and decoding, this is our next concept called decryption. Data packet will get decrypted, okay, and it will be verified across which policy it is going out. Once policy verification is done, then only this security profile verification will happen. Okay, so first it will check, is it part of any vulnerability signature? Is it carrying any vulnerability signature? Then it is verifying for malware. It is verifying for botnet and IRC chat services. Okay. And it will verify for malicious file types like .exe. Now, you know, we can specify data filtering. This is called as extension-based filtering. Okay. And it will verify even data match content. Nothing but, is it matching any malicious content? So all this will be parallelly verified. Based on that, a policy will be enforced. Just to give you an example, what I am going to do is, now I have a data packet. See here, MS thing. See here. Now, this is my Palo Alto device. Okay. And this is my data plane. A user who is sitting here trying to reach a web server over here. Now the traffic is passing through this. Yes. So when it is passing through your ingress interface, as we discussed, it is going to verify first, is it from which zone? Going to which zone? Between these two zones, is there any policy exist? If policy exists, then it is going to verify with security profile. Okay. So if you even look into this, once security policy is allowed, then only the packet will go to the next level, that is security profile. Okay. Security profile, once again, verifies multiple things. If you look at here, it will verify antivirus, it will verify URL filtering, it will verify anti-spyware, file blocking, vulnerability, data filtering. All this you can put into a single security profile group also. Instead of you have to attach individually, you can just put a group, security profile group. Okay?
Okay.
So, antivirus, how it works, we know. Antivirus, there is a database with all the virus database. So, in this, there is database, you know, malicious signatures will be written. There are signatures written in this. Each and every packet will be inspected. Is it part of the signature? No. Is it part of the signature? No. Is this part of the signature? It will verify across the malicious signatures. Okay? So if it is part of a malicious signature, what happens? then this traffic is going to be dropped here itself. First, what it will verify? First, it will verify antivirus. So how it works? So we are going to see that practically. Give me 1 second.
Okay. So, but in the SP3 architecture, like the packet kind of gets divided into three, like the packet
divided into three, but all the security process will be done by one processor. We discussed all the network traffic will be done by one processor. All the encryption and decryption done by one processor, isn't it?
Right.
Okay. So all the security process will be done by only one processor.
Correct.
But parallelly it is doing.
Correct.
Okay. So
this, all this thing like this and this content ID falls under the security process.
Yes.
Okay.
And even for example, in one security profile, we have hundreds of things like antivirus, web filtering, URL filtering, content filtering. Those also will be simultaneously verified by your Palo Alto processor, that is security processor.
Agreed. Okay.
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 So now let me see how to configure this antivirus. Okay. First, let me go through with my policy. So this is my policy. Previously we didn't enable any profiles, right? This is what we have done earlier.
Right.
And we don't have any authentication or something at that time. Okay. Now, what we are going to do? First, we are going to verify. As we know, antivirus is purely a signature-based database, right?
Right.
Any antivirus that might be. So, here in your, once you purchase antivirus, here you can see antivirus version also. Currently, how it is showing, excuse me, this URL filtering version and all the stuff, it will show you antivirus version because of the signatures. Okay. And even in your device, you can see in licenses what version of antivirus you installed. See here. Here you can see all your antivirus version, your content filtering version, URL filtering version and all the stuff. Okay. Here in content ID settings, what you need to do, automatic update you need to enable here. Okay. This is automatically updated by default. So you want to change timing, then you can change time based on, see, every 15 minutes what I specified, every 168 hours, dynamic URL filtering will get updated. Content filtering will get updated automatically from Palo Alto Networks. Now you have to verify your version and you need to keep it continuously update. Okay. So by default, using management IP address only, this will get updated. Now assume like that. I kept my management IP address in internal network. Assume like that. I didn't connected management on internet connected. At that time, you need to go to service route configuration. Remember here, service route configuration, and you can see updates, all the updates, not only this. See here, URL filtering updates. You have to specify your internet connected interface here. Your internet connected interface. Okay? Because by default, it will take, by default option is use management interface for all the things.
Okay.
Okay? For example, if you are trying to connect to Palo Alto Network Services, for what purpose? Firmware update and all the stuff. Then you have to change. If your management is getting internet, you need not to change anything. remember. If your management is not getting internet, at that time definitely you have to
change it.
Change it. See, even external dynamic list. External dynamic list will be given by Palo Alto to you. Okay? That you have to enable and commit. Or else, what happens? It will try to update antivirus signatures using your management interface only. When it can't able to update, it can't able to block virus. Okay?
Got it.
Now what I'm going to do is, before installing this, I'm trying to download a virus.
So, for these antiviruses that we are getting updates from Palo Alto, do we have to pay anything extra to Palo Alto?
Palo Alto Content ID license includes all the things.
Okay.
Content ID includes antivirus. Okay. WildFire is different once again. WildFire is including malware and all the stuff. Okay. WildFire license is different license. You need only antivirus. At the time, if you purchase Content ID license, you will be getting all the blacklist IP addresses, that is spamming IP addresses. Okay. You will be getting URL filtering updates. You will be getting content filtering updates. You will be getting one more of these, that is dynamic URL updates. Okay. If you want IPS, you have to pay different. Okay. If you want WildFire is for malware analysis. Understand the difference between virus and malware. Antivirus is a only virus defender. Anti-malware will give you full protection from all the threats.
Okay.
Okay. WildFire is meant for malware protection and sandboxing. So, malware protection is a different license. App ID, application ID is a different license. Content ID is a different license.
Okay.
Content ID includes all these things which we are discussing now. Here, all this includes Content ID. Antivirus, URL filtering, anti-spyware, file blocking, vulnerability, and data filtering.
Okay.
But remember, vulnerability signatures, once again, you need to purchase an IPS engine. Except vulnerability here, all the five are part of your security profiles.
Security profiles, okay.
Right. Now, what I'm doing is, before installing any policy, before applying any antivirus policy, I'm trying to download malicious file. I'm trying to download, give me one second, I enable decryption. I'll disable decryption. Okay, now you can see I'm trying to download malicious file, virus file, anti-malware test file from eicr.org. See, it is downloading, right? It is downloading here. Okay, right. Now what I'm doing is I'm closing this browser and I will clear cache. Remember, if you are doing this experiment, don't do it on your host machine. Do it on a VM, because this virus file is a malicious virus file.
Okay.
Okay. Now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to my objects, antivirus. I'm specifying there is a default antivirus profile. Okay. Now what I'm saying is, I'm creating my own antivirus profile. I'm saying that if any virus is coming through FTP, what action I want to take? Drop. HTTP, drop. IMAP, if you say allow, it will send only allow. It will allow it. If you say alert, you will get an alert through your SNMP, but data will be allowed. If you say drop, it will get drop. It will say reset client. Client side, it will get disconnected.
Okay.
Okay, reset server, a fin flag will be sent from your browser to server to reset connection. Reset both, a reset flag will go from your machine.
Okay.
Drop, nothing will go from your machine. Through SMTP, I don't want to. And malicious packet you want to capture, you can enable packet capture also. But remember, when you enable packet capture, it will be overloading your CPU.
Correct.
Because your antivirus will be having 10,000 signatures. your packet is going through with all the 10,000 signatures, that entire will be captured.
Okay. So here in this action, if it drops, will it log that it has dropped?
Yes. Yes, it will log automatically. Okay, and wildfire action means I purchased content ID license as well as wildfire license. So antivirus, if anything is coming virus related, that will be dropped by my antivirus. If anything is coming Trojan, malware, rootkit and all the stuff, that I have to enable with wildfire only. For that, once again, you need to have wildfire license, remember. But we are using a trial version VM, 15 days, all features will work for us. Okay.
Okay.
And you have certain applications which you are running by default, which are blocked by your antivirus sometimes. So those applications you can whitelist here. For example, I have TeamViewer. So if TeamViewer application is running, don't identify it as a virus. Or else, a lot of times, what happens? Internal employees are having antivirus engine. For example, in internal network, in each system you installed an endpoint, which is having once again antivirus database. It try to connect to your server, antivirus update server, to get signatures. When signatures are getting downloaded, this will identify it as virus is downloading, because antivirus signatures are nothing but a virus. At that time, you have to whitelist your antivirus here.
Okay.
If you are having, for example, I have semantic antivirus. So my semantic will reach to this. You have to contact your Palo Alto for a semantic signature.
Okay.
By default, I don't have purchased application control. That's why it is not showing application of semantic. So if you are having purchased signatures, it will show you even signatures of that. Okay. Purchased signatures are different. Or else assume like that you are using a new version antivirus which is not there in market. Okay. You give your application name to Palo Alto, they will generate an application ID and they will give it to you. At that time, what you need to do? At that time, you need to create your custom signature in application that I will show you in application control. As of now, what we have seen is we enabled an antivirus profile through any protocol. If it is coming into my network, I kept a drop. Clear? Now what I am going to do, I am going to apply this antivirus profile to my security policy. In action, profile type is the right. I am saying, I have an antivirus profile called FLSAV. I applied this. Commit. Once you commit, now previously, if you remember, we downloaded malicious file from AICR.org, isn't it?
Right.
Now I'm trying to download the same file. What did he say?
Virus spyware download blocked.
Because of my?
Antivirus.
Remember, this can block only plain text protocol antivirus. What about encrypted? See, this is SSL enabled. Is it downloading or not?
Yes.
For this, we have another class called decryption. That is a dedicated module. Dedicated module to verify encrypted text across the multiple malicious signatures. Okay. Perfect.
So this, like, basically when you're trying to download, the traffic will be passing through the firewall. That's why firewall is blocking it to be downloaded to your machine.
Yes.
If you connect your PC like on the outside interface of firewall, you might be able to download to this.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now we have seen antivirus. How to prevent that HTTPS traffic, that we will see in other module. Okay. No need to worry about it. Currently also, even though you have antivirus, if it is encrypted virus or encrypted malicious data, not only virus, all the encrypted malicious data is flowing into your network, right?
Right.
Okay. So to avoid that, what you need to do is you need to enable decryption. Okay. That we are going to discuss in our next class.
Okay, fine.
Next module. Fine?
Fine.
So now, as of now, we've seen how antivirus will get, antivirus will identify virus signatures and get blocked. That we have seen. Here, in your real-time logs, you can see here, but because of VM, we can't able to see here. I recommend in your real-time logs in threat, it will show as virus got blocked here. You will see immediately a result there. EICR.org download. See here. You can see here user got connected. Because of antivirus signature, it can't able to show you that user got blocked. You can't see here. Because this is just allowed traffic. You want to see that, you have to see in threat. Because the traffic is allowed there, session is established. But the data transferring through that session is blocked. That we have to verify. Okay?
Okay.
So, or else, similar like previously what we have done, you can capture packet and you can see that also. You can capture packet and you can see that also. Okay?
Okay.
Done. Or else, even here in your ACC, it will show threat activity and blocked activity. Immediately. Because we are using a VM, we have limitations. Or else, directly you can see here that which user content is blocked and what content is blocked, everything it will show here. In your real time. Okay, you can see all your malicious data which is blocked. Perfect. Now we have seen antivirus, however, right? We are going to our next module. How to create, already we have seen. Okay, anti spyware. What is spyware? Hello,
yeah,
what is spyware?
Spyware is like trying to block certain types of traffic, certain types of data, I think.
No, spyware is nothing but it's a malicious script which will sit in your machine, okay, and send all your machine information to a remote hacker. Example is your keyloggers. Okay, spyware. For example, I'm a hacker. What I will do, I know that multiple users will be downloading and trying for a crack version of VMware workstations. So what I will do is, I will bind VMware workstation with my keylogger or Trojan or anything. Okay? So as you are downloading it from internet, I will put into foreshade.com or some any public website. What you will do is, you will download it and you will install it. So in backend, without showing to you, my keylogger will get installed into your machine. Henceforth, what it is going to do is, it is going to capture all your keystrokes, your login passwords, whatever you typed, including screenshots and all the stuff. Okay? That will be uploaded to my FTP server or my email account, whatever I have assigned. That is nothing but your spyware. Best example is keylogger.
Keylogger.
If you want more information, you can read about BPK keylogger in internet. Blazing Tools Perfect Keylogger. Okay? So, very easy. You bind with any software and you upload into internet. Whomever downloads that software, see here, you can enable here. What do you want to see? I want to see all his keystrokes. Whatever he opens, screenshots I can see. I want to see all the websites what he browsed. What charts he has done. Whatever key, even if you press escape key also, that will be recorded here. Okay, like that.
Yeah.
So these kind of tools will come under spyware. And even Trojans, you can see here. So, adware. These are also called as grayware. They are not going to create any problem for you. But they are creating disturbance for you. Those are grayware, name itself will tell you that they are not malicious. It won't contain any malicious signature. But it is going to disturb your regular work. Ads. If you open some sites without your intervention, automatically you'll be hitting some other sites, pop-ups and all the stuff, right?
Right, right.
Those are kind of adware, also called as grayware by other vendors. Backdoors. Backdoor is nothing but a entry point for the hacker. For example, the same VMware workstation, I binded with a backdoor. Backdoor is nothing but an entry point or a Trojan, which will sit in your machine. For example, I binded my VMware workstation with the Trojan instead of keylogger. And I am sending it to, I am uploading into foreshare.com, where you are going to download that particular malicious content and put it into your system. When you install it without your knowledge, backend it is going to get installed and it is going to give remote control of your system to a hacker. Okay? The best example is Beast Trojan. This best example is Beast Trojan is one of the best Trojan. And you can even see a remote access Trojan, RAT Trojan, you can say. A remote access Trojan. Lot of are there. Okay? Those are backdoors. What is botnet? You have any idea about botnet?
No.
Botnet is a very popular, even Google is using bot. Here, Google web crawling bot. What it means, have you observed any time if you are searching for Palo Alto training in Google, in your Gmail, once you log in, you will be getting advertisements related to Palo Alto Training Institutes. Have you observed this any time?
Yes, I observed it.
How Google got your information? Is it possible for Google to monitor each and every user's traffic, what they are searching for? Is it possible?
No.
So what they have done is they built a bot, also called as Spider. So Google bot is not malicious. They won't do any malicious things, but understand how bot works. See, this is your ISP gateway. I'm a hacker. What I will do is I'll just purchase or I will configure an IRC chat server. What server it is? IRC chat server on a public IP address. Okay? And I identified, okay, BSNL or some ISP's gateways are vulnerable. So what I will do, I will compromise this ISP router. Okay? I will configure a bot header. What is meant by bot header is nothing but bot header is a combination of all the malicious signatures. Not only thing, all the malicious signatures. Means Trojan, rootkit, spyware, all the virus and all the stuff. Bot header. Bot header is a combination of multiple malicious code, piece of code. Okay? I will show you bot header. See here, this is bot header. Bot header is nothing but it's a combination of multiple threads, also called as bot master. You can see here. Somebody kept here. Bot master. What it contains is, it contains all the malicious signatures. All the malicious signatures it contains. Okay. So what happens when a user is browsing some legitimate site? Okay. So what botnet is going to it is going to come back. See here, bot header, hacker who automated technique to scan specific network range, find vulnerable system where they can install their malicious data. I will show you if I didn't got. Sorry, nobody has given exact image. I will show you. See, bot header is nothing but combination of. See here, this is virus. This is Trojan. This is rootkit. Like this, I put all the malicious signatures, hundreds of malicious signatures. Now you are a legitimate user who are getting internet connection from this particular ISP. Okay? And you are sending your traffic to internet, some traffic to internet. When this ISP got compromised, what this bot header will do? It will send the reply traffic, reverse traffic to your machine. First it will send virus. No, your system is having antivirus. Then it will send Trojan. No, your system is also having internet security. Then it will send ransomware. So different malicious it will try. So all the end user systems are not secured with all the security features, isn't it?
Right.
To allow internet connection, what we do, most probably we'll disable our firewall, isn't it? Most of the time what we'll do, we'll disable our firewall. We won't write exceptions. What we do, we'll disable completely our firewall. Because of this, what happens? This can't be secured and the user will get infected with any of this. So once user got infected any of this particular system, a vulnerable system or a victim is called as a bot or zombie. Bot or zombie. So the code, the piece of code installed in this machine is having whom to contact. Directly he will contact to this particular IRC chat server. Hi boss, give me instructions what I have to do. From here, whatever instructions I will be passing to your machine will do those. For example, my target is XYZ, I want to attack on the target. So what I have done, I infected multiple bots. From here, I will be targeting my target. So if this user goes to police, who will get caught by police? This guy will get caught by police, not me. Okay? Like this, not only this, if any sensitive data is there in this particular system, I will upload those sensitive data into my server. Okay? Like this, we can do multiple things with this bot header or botnet, what we can say.
Okay.
Okay? Now we understand botnet. Botnet is controlled by what? IRC chat server. Right. By using IRC chat server, we are going to control. And the beauty of bot is, when antivirus scan is going on, it can stop automatically its signatures. And second thing is, there is a automated behavior of changing script randomly, changing signature randomly. For example, antivirus will be identified because of what signature? If I'm changing continuously signatures randomly, will it be identified by any antivirus? No. Best example for this you want to see is, go to Google and read about ZEUS bot. FBI released a documentation for FBI kind of company. It took continuously 40 days to take down this ZEUS bot. And 10 countries participated in it. You can read about it. That much dangerous bot is. Because the random changing of signature is the major, advantage of this here. More than 1 million infections. Key participation of 10 partner countries to take down the operation. You can see about it. You can read more about it here.
Correct.
Okay? Perfect?
Yes.
So browser hijack. Browser hijacking is nothing but session hijacking. You know, every time when you connect to browser, a session ID will be generated by a web server, which we'll call it as server cookie and client cookie. Okay? So what hackers will do, they'll do session hijacking. and data theft. Data theft is nothing but infect your machine and upload all your sensitive content into my particular server and blackmail you. Keylogger, already we discussed. WAM. What is WAM? WAM is nothing but it's a piece of code which will spread from one machine to another machine in a corporate network. For example, now understand, I have 100 systems in my network. 100 systems in my network. All are interconnected because of networking, right?
Right.
Most of the time in real time, we'll be having C dollar, D dollar, you know, some open drives. And we are exchanging data from among all the systems, isn't it?
Right.
So assume like that this user clicked a malicious link in internet where some malicious content got infected in his machine. Okay. So along with WAM, if I install as a hacker, what this WAM will do when there is a share, admin share to this machine, it will carry that malicious content into this machine. Okay. WAM is a piece of code which will spread by using admin shares like C dollar, D dollar, E dollar, like that. And in Linux networks, a lot of systems will be having root username and password. Okay, nowadays everybody become intelligent. Sometimes still without having knowledge, they won't keep any root passwords. So any open passwords, it is carrying this malicious data using SSH shares. Okay, secure shell shares. So what it will do, if one system got infected in a corporate network, this WAM is going to spread everything to all the systems. Okay?
Got it.
So peer-to-peer communication, we know torrents and all the stuff.
Right.
Spyware, all these are part of spyware only. Now what action you want to take? So I want to drop it or I want to, you know, allow it, it's up to me. But in real time, what we'll do? What we'll do in real time? We will drop, isn't it?
Correct.
And yes, most of the time, this peer-to-peer networks, like torrents and all the stuff, will be using DNS protocol, isn't it? In corporate network, is it possible to disable DNS?
No.
If I disable DNS, my internal users can't be able to communicate with external.
Correct. Yes.
So by default, you know, DNS requests are required for us. DNS is need to be opened in corporate network. Okay? But all the botnets or peer-to-peer communications identifies this. They'll be using DNS port only to allow or to communicate between peer-to-peer networks. To block those, what we need to do? We need to configure a DNS sync hole. Okay, by default, DNS sinkhole action is enabled in your Palo Alto device. How it works, understand. User will be sending query to your malicious server to an internal DNS. What internal DNS will do? However, your internal DNS won't be having IP address of this server. So it will send that request to public DNS. Okay?
Okay.
So DNS signature match query dropped by your firewall. And then firewall returns sync hole IPv4 and IP address to host. Host system, you know, will be sending a sync hole request. Infected host identified using firewall logs and reports. Means even though the packet is getting dropped, what we are doing is we are creating a sync hole IP address. So what happens? User don't know that. Even though packet get dropped, the response will be received by user, okay, about the IP address of sinkhole as the IP address of this malicious server.
Okay.
Okay. So user will try to connect to that particular sinkhole IP address. So you will identify by reading logs that infected host is trying to connect to what malicious server? Who are getting infected in your network? Okay.
Okay.
So that is nothing but your DNS sync hole. By default, you can enable any interface IP address as DNS sync hole. Most of the time in real time, we will be using management IP address for sync hole.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
So what it is going to do is it is going to receive the request, and immediately you can see a message that this got given by your user is trying to, one system in network got infected with some malicious content, try to connect to a particular server, malicious server. For example, any spyware installed, for example, some hacker installed botnet in your system. Botnet, already we discussed, it try to contact to IRC chat server in public, isn't it?
Correct.
To connect to IRC chat server, once again, it will use DNS query, it will send a DNS query. Because it should know IP address of that particular server. Right. So DNS sync role we will configure. And one more thing is, lot of times hackers are intelligent, they won't put any DNS directly, they'll put IP address. So to avoid that, they will, what Palo Alto maintains? Palo Alto maintains all public IRC chat server IP addresses. Okay? Publicly available IRC chat server IP addresses, they put into blacklist IPs. If user try to connect to that particular also, it will get blocked. Even though it is not connecting through DNS, it will get blocked. Clear? To see this, what we can see, any malicious keylogger kind of stuff we need to install. Any keylogger kind of stuff we need to install and make sure that some public user is accessing it. For that, once again, we need to make lot and lot of setup. User, there will be a hacker system from where user will be connecting and all the stuff. That's not possible. How to enable, we can see here. So objects, spyware, see here. So this is your anti-spyware blade. Okay. So what you specified by default? Default strict and two different things are there. So I'm adding one more. So what rule I'm adding? Rule one, threat name is any. Threat comes under keylogger or DNS or autogen. No, it says any threat. Action is drop. I don't want to take risk. But remember, whenever you are selecting any, all the threats, your load will be high on your system.
Correct.
Right. Okay? So, or else you can say only critical, high and medium. It's up to you. So, I configured this. If you want to exempt some applications in your company, you can exempt here. Okay? DNS, as we discussed, we are going to create a sinkhole IP address here. You can configure a sinkhole IP address. Any interface IP you can configure here. Or you can create a new interface IP address also.
Okay.
Okay, so here by default, this is Palo Alto's sinkhole IP. So in logs, if any traffic is going to this IP, means your network, some system got infected. So you have to look into that particular system IP address.
Understood.
Okay, say okay. And what you need to do? Go to your policy and attach this security profile or this spyware protection to your anti-spyware to your policy and commit here. Clear?
Clear.
This is about anti-spyware. Next one is vulnerability protection. What vulnerability protection? Vulnerability protection is going to protect your servers from attacks. Okay? Protect your servers from attacks. Okay. There are two types of vulnerability protections. Actually, this is like IPS. Okay? This is like IPS. So, we know how IPS works, right? There are two different types of protections in IPS, vulnerability protection. One is anomaly based detection, nothing but your behavior based detection. And second one is signature based detection. Okay? Signature based detection. And this vulnerability protection will work only as a signature based detection. What it means is See, let's understand how IPS signature works. So it will be very clear for you that, you know, how this can be blocked. Assume like that you are a security guy, you are a security analyst. You purchased some product today. You are using Microsoft Office. Okay. You identified a vulnerability or a security weakness. Vulnerability is nothing but a weakness which will compromise your security. So you identified a vulnerability with that particular product. Now what you will do?
With that vulnerability, we have to try and detect it first of all.
So that's what, you are a security analyst. You identified a vulnerability. So with your enthusiasm, you tried, you exploited even it. You exploited it. Now what you will do? As a security analyst, what's your job to do?
To detect the source, like from where it is coming, basically.
No. Fine. Because it's a product, isn't it? You purchased Microsoft Office. In Microsoft Outlook or in Microsoft Word, you identified a vulnerability. Word is having a buffer exploit, buffer overflow exploit, or some vulnerability, some weakness.
Right.
What do you need to do?
Try to remove that particular weakness.
Do you have source code on Microsoft?
No.
Can you remove it?
No.
So what do you have to do?
You need to protect it from attacking the server or attacking.
So source code is not with you, right? How you can edit and change it? You can't change anything for that because it's a closed source. It's not open source. You can't edit and you can't do it. So what you need to do is report to Microsoft.
Okay.
You will report to Microsoft. What Microsoft will do, you will send all the POC. See, vulnerability is like this. Hacker can exploit like this. You send all the POC, proof of concept, to Microsoft. What Microsoft will do? They'll say, thanks for reporting. Okay. Thanks for reporting. Please don't disclose this vulnerability. We will identify your solution and we'll revert back to you. Okay. And they will look into that particular POC and identify where the vulnerability presents. And what they'll do, they will design a solution for it. They will design a solution for it. That is called as a patch. It is called as patch in English language. Once they release patch, lots of customers are there for Microsoft. Is it possible for them to intimate everybody?
No.
So what they will do, they will contact NVD. NVD stands for National Vulnerability Database. This is maintained by US Computer Emergency Response Team. US Computer Emergency Response Team. So what they will do is they will contact CERT saying that we identified a vulnerability with our product. Our product name is Microsoft. So what CERT will do, CERT will provide a form. CERT will provide a form, see here, National Vulnerability Database, NVD. If you look into this NVD, maintained by US CERT, as I told you. Okay? What is job of this CERT is to protect internet, because internet is US private property. Okay? Protecting of internet is their job. Okay? So, each and every vulnerability, see, once Microsoft reached to them, for what they will reach is, they will reach for an unique identity of vulnerability called as CVE, Common Vulnerability Exposure Identity. What it calls as? Common Vulnerability Exposure, CVE ID. Okay? So a form will be given to them like this. So what they need to fill, what can I need to request a CVE ID. This ID is unique for every vulnerability. Remember, this ID is unique for a vulnerability. So you will specify, for example, you are from Microsoft. Okay, Microsoft, what they will do, Microsoft security team will contact CERT for this. They will give their email address here. Okay, perfect. And they will mention how many CV, number of vulnerabilities reported or number of IDs you required. Only one vulnerability you identified with the current product, say one. Okay, so what type of vulnerability it is? Is it remotely exploitable? Means if that, for example, you identified a vulnerability with Microsoft Office installed in your machine. Remotely exploitable means a hacker who is sitting somewhere throughout the world can connect to it and exploit it. That is called remote exploitable vulnerability.
Right.
Local means only user who logged in the same computer where this Microsoft Office is installed. That is called local vulnerability. We have multiple vulnerabilities, DoS, denial of service, distributed denial of service. So what type of vulnerability is this? See, cross-site scripting, SQL injection, and different types of vulnerability. And which products of yours are vulnerable for this? I'll say Microsoft.
So this cert that we opened, so this will be opened by us, or in our example, this will be opened by Microsoft.
Yes, this will be opened by Microsoft. You can't open it until and unless you are a vendor. You can't open it.
Okay, got it.
You reported to Microsoft. Microsoft verified it. They agreed that vulnerability present with their source code. Then what they are going to do is they design a solution. After designing a solution, it is impossible for them to intimate everybody, isn't it? So automatically, to get it update to everybody, they will reach to this CVE. To automatically update everybody, there need to have a unique identity for the particular vulnerability.
Correct.
So to get that unique identity, they reach this NVD, National Vulnerability Database. So you are saying that, okay, Microsoft Office 2007 is vulnerable for this. So who are acknowledging? Vendor, that is Microsoft. Yes, we are acknowledging it. What type of attacks are possible? Remote attacks are possible. And it may give escalation of privilege. Hacker may execute his malicious code, whatever it is. And all the proof of concepts mentioned here. And who identified it? For example, if Microsoft is paying you money for identifying it, they will put on their name. No, you are not agreeing to take money from them for reporting. They will give credit to you. Getting my concept?
Getting it, yeah.
So, this how once they give, what happens? A unique identity will be given by CERT. If you want to see that, I recommend securityfocus.com. What I am doing is, for example, today I am managing Microsoft Office. I want to see only vulnerabilities related to Microsoft Office. So what I will do, see, if you know CVE number, you can type your CVE number here.
Right.
Assume like that I have a CVE number 2017-0001. There are some unique sequence. Okay, this signature is not matching because this is not the vulnerability. Give me 1 second. I will CVE 2017. I'll get one to show you just. Okay. This is just to show you what it is, how it looks like. Thank you. Are see here, if you click on the particular vulnerability, it will clearly show you what kind of vulnerability it is. See here. This is government site. It is very difficult to see. Whereas here we can see CVE ID. I will copy this. The security focus is on semantic initiative for this. See here. Now you got this?
Yes.
Now you understand what kind of this is vulnerability identity number. Is it exploitable for remote or local? Exploitable from remote.
Right.
What, when they identified it? Okay.
Yeah.
Who identified it?
Microsoft only identified.
When they identified solution?
Just in 2 days.
Okay. See here, what products of Microsoft are vulnerable for this particular vulnerability? Okay. What products are vulnerable for this particular vulnerability? And discussion related to that particular vulnerability. Okay. It's a privilege escalation vulnerability. Okay. And how a hacker will exploit it? Exploits, they won't put it here. To see exploits, people will look into exploit-db.com. See, this entire is not part of official curriculum. I am showing you only to make you more understandable. They will say only just CVE. That's it. What is CVE? How CVE works, I am showing here. If you are getting any doubt, please revert back to me.
Sure.
See here, they assume like that, I want to exploit F5 Big IB load balancer. So here I can download the script. See, this is exploit script. Okay. This is my exploit script. See here. This is called ticket bleed vulnerability. So all the company security guys will be continuously monitoring this CVE. For example, you are managing a Windows network today. So what you will do, you will be daily monitoring Windows vulnerabilities day by day. So if some new CVE came, you will look into it, you will directly download it, and you will check whether it is critical or medium priority, whatever it is. Okay? So based on the criticality, what you are doing? You'll be taking change management permission in your company and you'll immediately apply the patch. Okay? So, all the vulnerabilities, vulnerability database will be stored with CVE identity. Every vulnerability will be having a unique identity called Common Vulnerability Exposure Identity.
Okay.
So, what Palo Alto is going to do here is, not only Palo Alto, any other vendor, what they do is, Palo Alto will be having a dedicated security team. A dedicated security team. They will maintain a database. Today, some 10 CVEs got reported by some vendors. Oracle reported to SUSE reported 10, like that. So what these guys will do? All these vulnerabilities and exploit signatures. Okay, when they look into this vulnerability, some companies like Sophos, they are having their own internal team who will write exploits for these particular vulnerabilities. Okay, and all the exploit codes of this particular vulnerability stored in this database.
Understood. Okay.
Okay. Now, assume like that, I have internal web server, or I have a F5 SSL, I have F5 exploit here. We downloaded, we have seen, right? That exploit here. Now some hacker from public try to exploit that particular exploit. So when I enabled IPS, what happens? First it will verify, is it matching this exploit signature? Is it matching this exploit signature? If it matches this exploit signature, then it will be identified as an exploit and it will get dropped here itself.
Okay.
Is it clear now?
Yes.
That is vulnerability protection. means all the CVEs will be maintained as a database by your Palo Alto. So what happens whenever you are updating, all the signatures will get updated locally in Palo Alto device database, your PAN device database. So whenever a traffic is hitting to your data plane, it will be going through with each and every signature. If no malicious thing matches, then only it will go out. If any malicious identified, based on the action what you specified allow, it will allow. If you specified alert, it will send alert, still it allows. If you specify drop, that attack will get dropped. Clear?
Clear, yes.
So, in once again, each and every vulnerability is having high, medium, low, and critical, different priorities. Based on the severity, it is going to affect on your network.
Okay.
Okay. Now, you want to block all severity. Whenever you are saying all severity, you know, you have 67,000 vulnerabilities. Is it possible for a single packet to go through with all 67,000 signatures within 30 seconds?
Not possible.
After 30 seconds, there is a default service called Watchdog, which is going to interrupt your scan and drop the packet. So what need to be done? Within 30 seconds, your packet need to be verified with all the IPS signatures. So what you have to do? You have to enable only limited CVEs which are required for your company. For example, in vulnerability database, you will get signatures of Microsoft, you will get signatures of Cisco, you will get signatures of Red Hat, you will get signatures of Oracle. For example, just take an example of operating systems. You have Windows operating system signatures, Linux signatures, Mac signatures, all the stuff. But my internal network is only Windows. We need to enable all the signatures.
Even that will have a lot of signatures.
Same, that's what. See, instead of verifying 67,000, verifying 23,000 is good. Once again, in Microsoft also, they need to, am I using Windows 95, 97, 2000, XP and all the stuff?
Only for 2010 basically, whatever.
So whatever currently your company is using, you will select only those once again.
Correct.
So this is called fine-tuning IPS. This is called fine-tuning IPS. Most of the times in real-time administrators are not, intelligent about this. Administrators, see, most of the time IPS, who will handle? Security team or network team?
Security team.
But in real time, network team only handling IPS, not a SOC team.
Okay.
SOC team guys don't know about hardware devices of IPS. NOC team knows IPS, but they don't know about what is vulnerability signature, what is exploit signature and all the stuff. Okay. So, this fine-tuning, who can do? A guy who is having knowledge of both NOC and SOC, he only can do fine-tuning of this. So, based on the applications you are having in your network, based on the operating system you are having on network, based on the routers, switches, firewalls you are having on your network, you need to enable those vulnerability signatures instead of enabling all. Is it clear?
Clear, clear.
But here in our example, because however we don't have purchased signature database, here vulnerability protection. It is saying strict default. Strict means everything, all high, critical and medium will get blocked. Okay. See here, if you double click on strict, it shows this will be identified based on any CVE, any threat of critical risk, high risk, medium risk, information risk. Okay. Low risk. So, when you identified some critical vulnerability related to any vendor, it might be related to Microsoft, it might be related to... No, in my network, I don't have... See, in my network, I have Cisco, Microsoft. Only two things. Do I need to enable all CVEs? So, I will create my own, vulnerability protection. What I will say... Rule name, block malicious. What I am doing is, in my network, I have only vendors. Microsoft is vendor. Okay. You need to identify vendor IDs, because it is not purchased, it is not showing nothing to me, right?
Right.
You can say Microsoft. You can say Cisco. You can say Juniper. These are the products which is used in my network. Right. So any three related vulnerabilities, any vulnerability. No, if I know vulnerability, I can specify CVE numbers here, CVE IDs. No, I don't know any vulnerability. So what I'm saying, instead of all, critical, high, medium risk, I want to drop. Okay? Are you getting my concept?
Yes.
It might be related to brute force attack. It might be related to DOS attack. It might be related to buffer overflow attack, scanning of your network, anything it might be. So what I specified is drop I specified. Is it clear?
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, give me one second. Half of them. Bolo. Theek hai bhai. Abhishek ka number hai na aapke paas? Kar do. Okay. Okay. ठीक है. पूरा डिटेल्स आप मेल भेज दो मुझे. आई कैन डू इट. 10 बजे तक मेरा ट्रेनिंग चलते रहता है. 10 बजे के बाद ही मिलता आपको. ठीक है. ओके. सॉरी. See here, you can see those vulnerability. If any those attacks are happening on your network, you can defend those attacks in your network. So most of the time, will we do this for LAN to internet or internet to LAN?
Internet to LAN.
Why we attach to LAN to internet here? In real time, we won't attach to LAN to internet. Because when traffic is going from LAN to internet, if you are starting scanning, your network will get scrubbed out. Just to show you, I have configured here. In real time, what you need to do is, in real time, we won't even configure it. We'll configure, most of the time, there will be DMZ. Yesterday, we have seen, on public IP address, we are configuring NAT. We configured policy, right? See here, this policy. For this policies, we'll attach that spyware. Okay, you got my point here.
So basically, the place where we are doing the destination NAT.
Yes. For that policy, if you configure this, what happens? If anybody from public are trying to attack this particular web server or FTP server which you have configured, that will get dropped because of this policy.
Okay.
Most of the time, from LAN to internet, we won't configure vulnerability protection, really. Okay, some companies even do that. Why? Because when user, because forget about vulnerability protection. For others content IDs, we even allow local user to prevent, right?
Right.
So for reply traffic also, it will verify for signatures, not only from send traffic. Either packet is going out or packet is coming in, both the ways, both the directions, it will do inspection of vulnerability signatures.
Okay.
But in real time, where we will write is where we configure NAT and all the stuff, there only we will write.
Okay.
Perfect. So you can see those logs in threat logs. URL filtering. We know what is URL filtering. Palo Alto supports two different databases. One is PAN-DB, which is Palo Alto database of URL filtering. Second one is BrightCloud database. Okay, there are two different types of database which is supported by Palo Alto for URL filtering. Here itself, you can see in content filtering, you can see URL filtering. This is PAN-DB. No, I purchase BrightCloud. While you are purchasing, you have both options. You want to purchase it with PAN-DB or you want to purchase with BrightCloud. BrightCloud is a third-party service. Once again, you have to pay more to get it. Okay.
Okay.
So while you are purchasing, they will ask you, you want to have Brightcloud URL filtering or Palo Alto PanDB. It's up to you which you want to. Okay. So here you have to check out which one you purchased. If it is Brightcloud, it says Brightcloud URL filtering.
I see. Okay.
Okay. Or else it will say PanDB. Because right now it is unlicensed, no? You can see only PanDB.
Right. So, so this PanDB is there by default?
Yes, it's by default. By default, if you didn't purchase Brightcloud, you will get PanDB by default. Hello? Net to disconnect, Vijay. Yes.